even the child, if she or he wants milk, he has to cry. You know, then only the mother will give you the milk. You know, ask for it. Otherwise, it's difficult to reach. You know, I don't have all the mobile numbers, and I don't have the habit of, you know, chasing students. You know, I don't believe in that. I never been chased. If I'm interested, I submitted. If I'm not interested, I never submitted and I never received marks. So if you're not interested, that is fine. It's up to you. But the only thing is you lose marks. And after all, our system is also based on marks. So please submit. If you have any problems, come and talk to me, call me, send me an email. Bahasa, anything is fine. English is not a big thing. I make mistakes. In my lecture, there are so many mistakes that I come, you know, come to know. When I go back, I show it to others. So you should not worry about the language. The only thing is, you are interested to learn, you are interested to communicate. So it will be okay. Okay, so we will finalize that so that I can put all your titles also on the page. I can send it to other section members so that they also know what term papers that you are writing, so that there is no manipulation. And the group work, the group project, I think we should begin. It's already one, you know. How many months? 1 month? Yeah. So you know what? Some of the group projects very good. I mean, for example, I remember Vasumati and Trashnavi and one more. Rabi. So three of you. Who is this Rabi? I'm trying to understand, you know. So okay, now you know, they came up with three things and we discussed, and I don't know what they have finalized, but I have to know about the interesting that they're going to do it. The donation of hormones, the human hormones, you know. Very interesting story it will come. You know, in Malaysia it's very important. A lot of work has already been done. I have never looked into that. Now that they are doing that, now I started reading on that. There's so much written on that. So you know, we can expect a very good presentation, good insights, a good debate from that group work, which comes under medical policy or health policy or human organ donation policy, whatever you call it. There's already a lot of work is started. Another group work that I received by me. There's only one. I think another one I received. Three people again. Anyway, I have those details, we'll see. Huh? Is yours? Sorry?
What is the campus?
Not political campus. I think they've changed also. Anyway, I'll see that. So let us finalize that so that you know we can start talking about that. Okay, now that 9 o'clock. Welcome to week 4. I'm very thankful because you guys are good, active, and we can see we are moving. So what is that we will learn today? What do you think? What are your expectations? Week 1, again I'll do this. Till the week 14, I will keep doing this. By week 14, you should be able to remember all things that you have learned. Week 1, what you have done. Week 2, what you have done. Week 3, what you have done. This is also a technique. I think it helps. It helps me and helps you. So what is that we have done in week 1? I think the key word, policy. Week 2? Welfare state. Week 3, institutions, mechanisms, maybe a little bit more in welfare, the types of welfare. And today the key word is policy making process, or policy making. Because till now we've been discussing what is policy, what is state, what is welfare. Why are we doing this? We want to understand social policy and how social policies or public policies are being made. So that is the only thing that we will learn today. What is this policy you know now? You know, a little bit at least. What kind of policies, types of policies, you know, the importance of policy in our lives. What else do you know about policy? You know, enjoying this policy business or not? If not, you might know. That's what it says. If students are not interested in policy, politics, even now, there is something, you know, we need to do.
Your
interest at least.
Yes.
I don't know.
Because all the time, whenever the Prime Minister presents his budget, the way we were looking at it was different. And this time when you were presenting it, we were looking at it in a different perspective.
Okay.
What policy is trying to do and all those things.
Interesting. Thank you very much. If that inquisitiveness is not there, then this study will be very boring. That's what I mean. I mean, I was never interested in policies, for example, before I have started my thesis. What is big thing? Anyway, we can't do anything. The same thing. You know, someone will prepare the policy and it will, you know, forced on us. Alone, I can't do anything. It is not my job. It is politicians, you know, who will do this. It is the World Bank who, you know, we can't do anything. It is a little pessimism. But then I started realizing, no, even I can influence policy. For example, through my thesis, it's called expertise. You know, the thesis I have done on irrigation reform policies in Andhra Pradesh. People started referring. I went and presented somewhere before the, you know, ADB, before World Bank. Maybe some people picked up somewhere. You know, there's a lot of discourse. Maybe one day it will change. It's already changing. Maybe. So you don't realize your contribution. That's what I'm trying to tell you. The thing that you're doing now, you're already part of the, you know, this politics. You're already part of this policy making. You're already part of, you know, this thinking. I'm sure one day you will be very, very influential. Like those 16 women on the Penang monthly magazine. I also sent you something else. Have you seen that? The Penang Institute is coming up with education course. I thought you will come.
Education.
Huh? Is possible?
Yeah.
I'm also trying to come. And so that we can come back and then talk about that. They're talking about blueprint for education, higher education. They're talking about policies. So if you know a little bit, we can go and ask certain questions. What are you talking? We don't understand. Can you explain more? You know, I'm sure that something will come there. So we'll try and go there and then come back and discuss. Otherwise, Penang Monthly Institute, why should they talk about this? People come and have tea and have some cakes and some discussion in five-star hotels and they go back. Nothing will happen. People say that it's a criticism of all this. But there is such a truth in that, but there's also such a fact in that is that these discussions are useful. It triggers somewhere, some idea, some conversation, some thinking, and someone will pick it up. That's the idea for the whole discussion series or whatever you call it. So today we will learn what is this policy making process. I said process. What is process?
The way we
reach to something. Okay, it's a process. Means it's not just one time. It's not static, it's dynamic, it's moving. We're talking about a certain period, process. What else? When we say process, what else comes to us?
Procedures.
There are certain procedures involved so that you can move on, or the process will go on. It will continue, it will not stop. There is a time period, there is an expectation, and there is a procedures involved. What else? Process. Process. Very common word. Can be used just like that. But I think it has a lot of things in it to offer. Process. It consumes some resources. Okay? Process. Marriage is a process. You know? Right from the selection of the bride to, you know, what else? Process. There are a series of stages. There are a lot of resources required. Okay? What else? A lot of decision making takes place in each stage. Otherwise, the process stops there. You know? Okay, you have decided to come to USM for 2 years, but you know, you could not make another decision and you could not continue the next semester. Stop. So a lot of decision making involved. There are a lot of stages involved. There are a lot of resources involved. What else? A lot of challenges, okay? A lot of challenges. So you can expect a lot of challenges when we are talking about process. What else? Helping is a process. Social work is what? Again, I'm bringing social work every time. The idea is that you should know, I'm a social worker, why do I worry about this policy? But we discussed at the beginning, you know, social workers actually involved in social policy. Helping process. Social work is a helping process. At the end, we may reach our goals or not, but we go through that. All the steps. Okay, what else? So process is about resources, process about is procedures, process is about decision making, process is about, what else? Changes, challenges, what else?
Analysis,
okay.
Reflection,
okay. Analysis, where do we need to analyze? How this process is going on? Is it going the way we want, the way we visualize, the way we planned, or not? am I achieving, you know, will I graduate in 18 months or 3 semesters, or will I graduate in 6 semesters? You know, you keep reflecting, you keep questioning your own performance, you keep tracking your own achievements. Okay, I'm moving, good, I finished. Now I'm second semester, now I'm third semester, I'm already thinking about the research. What else? There's a lot of things coming, process. Maybe we can talk about the whole thing on this process.
Bureaucracy.
Okay, a lot of bureaucracy. Okay, sometimes your process is full of bureaucracy. That means it's a top-down decision making. Maybe bureaucrats are people who follow blueprints. That's what they said, no? It's a blueprint for higher education. I think Osmati says, we don't know what is this blueprint all about. So to contribute, what is this blueprint? Models. You know? So they have a model, they have a blueprint, because earlier they used to make some, all the plans, they used to have a copy, there is a blue color, you know, paper they used to use. That's why I think it's called blueprint. Nowadays maybe they don't use it. I don't know exactly what is the word blueprint. Finalized, final product, whatever, on a sheet of, you know, paper, everything. When they print, I think it used to come, it's a carbon paper, it used to come in blue or whatever. Basically, it's fixed. It's there, and you follow and you implement. And you, it will teach you, or it will take you to the last process or last stages or whatever. What else? So it's model thinking. When you're talking about process, it is about procedures, it's about resources, it's about decision making, it's about challenges, it's about aspirations, it's about stages. What else? Maybe we can go on like that. So when we are talking about policy making, it's a process. It's not just one step. Nazib, you know, thinks, you know, late night and it becomes a no policy. Maybe yes, but still he has to go through a lot of steps. Maybe he has to introduce his idea with the cabinet. The cabinet will help him. Okay, this is not a good idea. Okay, this is good idea. There's some discussion. Maybe then he'll ask some bureaucrats to write a blueprint, and they will write. There will be modifications. It's a process. We'll go on to that. What else? Policy making process.
It's about the mission. Achieving mission.
It's about a mission. Achieving vision. Okay. So it's all there. That, you know. The vision is there, the mission is there, the strategies are there, the targets are there, the results are there, everything is there. So that you can achieve. And once the process is going on, you make sure that process is on so that you will achieve. Okay, what else? Policy making process.
Steps.
Huh? Steps. Mm-hmm. So when we are talking about policy making, we are talking about steps. We are talking about vision, we are talking about achieving something. Okay? So that is what we will try and understand today. So there are two schools of thought in policy making. One school of thought, or a group of people, think that it is linear. I'll show you. Before that, I want to show you this. You want to compete? This is a Malaysia public policy competition. Every year it's going on. You can see that. There are pictures. If you get selected, if your team gets selected, you can go on and they can give you a special training, a lot of praises. Why are they doing this? Maybe we can come back. You can see that Malaysia Public Policy Competition blogspot.com, like us, budding social workers. So you can see that there are a lot of emphasis on policy analysis, policy understanding, policy making, policy advocacy. You name anything with policy, you can see that. Malaysia, it's already happening. You are not the only guys who are into this. Okay, so this is what I thought we will do this today. What is policy making? Is it a process? Is it just one step? Or what is that? And why to analyze a policy and how to analyze a policy? So, policy process. We'll try and understand this process. And by doing that, you know, to do that, we ask these three questions. Why to analyze, after all? And if you want to analyze, how you want to analyze? What are the tools that are available for you? Why you want to analyze, for example? I think it has come. It is a process. We need to analyze where we are. are we, you know, in the right direction or not? For what else we should analyze? If you analyze the policy, what happens? Will that any make any difference? Okay, complete checking. When you analyze, you check and balance. Okay, maybe we are not moving, maybe we have to change the mid-course corrections. Okay, what else? Maybe there are other interesting things that come out when we analyze the policy. Maybe we can revise, or we can change the direction, we can change the tools. There's so much that can happen when you keep on analyzing. This is what the bureaucrats does in the National Planning Commission. And how to analyze. If you really want to analyze, what are the tools? Any idea how to analyze? Any tools that you already knew? Is Malaysia one policy is good? Or not good? Is it required for the country? Is it timely? Is it appropriate? What are your answers? Is medical policy is good or health policy is good? You say yes or no. When you say yes, on what basis you are saying yes? Or you say no, on what basis you are saying no? There's something happening here. And it helps you to say yes or no, or I don't know, I'm not sure. Whatever is your answer, there's something happens here. Otherwise, you will not say. Well, what happens here when you say yes or no?
Critical analysis.
You already do a critical analysis when you say yes. Okay, what is that? How do you do that? One Malaysia, take any example. Let's say One Malaysia, for example. You already do a critical analysis before say yes or no, because you are putting your opinion in public, space. You are making a decision. You are making an opinion on that. How do you do that? How do we do this, including me?
By observation.
By all one. Okay, you observe and you say something. Okay, observation. Do we really observe all these policies all the time? Okay, now I'm observing health policy. Okay, I'm looking at education policy. But knowingly, unknowingly, it's happening here. Okay.
How much it improves or enhances the development or the welfare of the people who are receiving it?
Okay, again, you're making your own statement. How is this making any influence or not? You're seeing, one Malaysian policy, nothing is happening. Only, Nazib is saying, but there's nothing happening. Oh, there's so much is happening. It's good. It's uniting the country. You're seeing, you're perceiving. So whatever you're saying, yes or no, is based on your own observation, your own perception, your own analysis. What else? Are you using any tools like observation? What else? Your own experience. Maybe you didn't get anything out of that. So you say, no. What box is that? Not that. I didn't do anything. There's so many people, I have not received anything. So your own benefits. If you are benefited, maybe you will say it's good. So you bring your own experience. What else? This is what analysis, though we don't think it is analysis. We are already analyzing it. You are bringing your own observation, your own participation, your own benefits. What else? Maybe sometimes, my friends are saying it's good, so it must be good. Like movies. Oh, this movie is good? Yeah, good. Okay. Public opinion, yes. Surveys, I don't know how much. Most of the time we may not do surveys, but you never know. You may enroll in one survey and then you do the results and you say that. Look, I was involved in this research and I know the results. And this is good. What else? Reading, yes. Newspapers. You read and you agree with that. Okay, then Kim is saying this medical policy or medical tourism policy is bad for Malaysia because a lot of Indonesians coming and all the hospitals are focusing on them and they're not focusing on Malaysians, so it's bad. Though it's good for economy, but it's bad for local Malaysians. So you also think, it's correct. Oh, I agree. So you make a choice. You say yes, medical tourism is bad. What else? What are the other ways we analyze normally?
Changes in
community. Okay, you see the results and then you make your choice, you're analyzing. Media, newspapers, friends, teachers, you're all influencing,
when it comes to your analysis.
But there are other ways of
doing analysis, which we will discuss today.
Very few techniques we have. Anything else? Okay, now, till now what we've discussed in this 20 minutes is that what is policy making process? What is process? Is policy making a process? Why do we need to analyze a policy? And how do we need to analyze a policy? Interestingly, this word politics has not yet come. But I think it looks like it's very important when you want to analyze the policy. Why is that? Politics. I hate politics. So I hate policies. Because? Politicians, they are the ones who are influencing the policies. They are the ones who are making the policies. So when I want to analyze the policy, there is no way but to look at this, the politics and politicians. So when we are talking about policies, we are actually talking about politics. Difficult, huh? Actually, when you are talking about policy, you are talking about politics, you are talking about state, you are talking about welfare, you are talking about what else? You are talking about government. You name anything, when you are talking about policy, it connects. That's the beauty of policy. It's like social work. You talk about anything, it connects to social work.
It's the beauty of complication.
To me, it's beauty. I mean, it's not complication. After all, your whole life is like that. If you really think in that way. So, is another important word for us. Since we're discussing the basics, I'm trying to emphasize on basics. Once we get the basics right, you will be the expert. It's not difficult. So what is after politics? We see politics in the classroom. We see politics in the family. We see politics in the country. We see politics among the friends. We see politics in the media, right? What is this politics? Influencing power. There is a word about power there, of course. What else? What else? Politics. Our day-to-day understanding. Hey, don't play politics with me, huh? What do you mean by that? Changing what?
Agent of changing.
Okay, politics is an agent of changing. Okay, what else? How it changes? How it changes as a, how it can be an agent? Politics in Bahasa is politics?
Yeah.
So you know, maybe there are different levels. When we are talking about politics, we are talking about different levels. You can see this. It is an attempt to explain various ways in which power is exercised in everyday world. Politics is nothing about power. So policies is nothing but politics. Politics is nothing but power. So policies is nothing but power. Simple mathematics. No? Agree or not? You don't agree. Simple. We are saying policies is all about politics. Because that is where all these things happen. And politics is nothing but power. What is this? On a Monday morning, what is this? What is this? But it's a good injection, you know, for the whole week.
Maybe we can rephrase it.
Okay.
Politics is about getting the power.
Politics is about getting the power. I would say politics is all about grabbing the power. Okay, agree. When you say grabbing the power, what do you mean by that? So there's something called power, and you grab that, and you make policies, and they affect the lives. So how do you grab this power? What is, how it looks like? We can't see God, okay, I agree with that. But we, can we see power, at least?
Yes.
How? There are types of power, it seems. There are covert power, there are overt power. We can go on that, but there's something called power. It is an attempt to explain various ways in which power is exercised. We are all powerful. Equal, you know, all, you know, Ben 10 or whatever, you know, I also have a watch, you also have a watch, you know, you also have some power, you know, this one. So there's no losers, there's no winners, all powerful. Can we still use that word power? The moment we are saying power, powerful, there is someone called powerless. Otherwise, there's nothing called power. So how do we understand power now? There is someone who can make decisions. And there's someone who can't make decisions. What else? How do we understand power? In our own simple terms. Power is what? Bahasa. So means what? Someone who can make decisions on behalf of you. You may like it, you may like it, you may not like it. But you have given that power to him or to make those decisions. What else?
Someone who
leads
it. They get the power and
lead
it.
Lead it, okay? Power to lead, okay? What else? What else? Authority, yes. Another important word. Authority. More confusion. What is authority? The one who uses power. I'm not trying to make it complex. Please look into these words. Once you are very clear about these words, your social work, your social policy, your social administration, all that will be fine. It will be very interesting then. Otherwise, we just take it granted and we don't get into this. And the idea of the classroom discussion is to get into those basics and trigger you right here. To me, power is, something can be not only grab, but also can be acquired, maybe. Acquired, power can be acquired. I am a son of a sultan. Automatically, the power is acquired. I acquire all the facilities, ascribed and prescribed. I can go on like that. It's acquired and prescribed. So we'll try and understand some of these words. So politics, how that power is used to allocate resources, to make decisions, to give away some benefits to some people, not others, and costs, burdens to other people. So there's so many ways that we can see power, which is playing, a power playing field. Politics is all about a power playing field. So if you understand that way, so when you're talking about policies, you're also talking about power, you're also talking about authority, you're also talking about state. Okay, let's move on a little bit more. I think we've discussed this, but you think, is there anything new here? Studying of public policy or studying of social policy, whatever. Studying public policy or policy analysis is nothing but looking at how the decisions are being made, either in the government or in the non-government. For what? To address a problem that a significant number of people and groups consider to be important and need of a solution. Okay, I have a lot of power. I make a lot of decisions. But no one needs those decisions. Is that a power? Can you see a situation like that? For example, oil. I have a lot of oil. I keep changing the price of the oil. But in the world, there is no need for oil anymore. Because people are running their cars on air, on water, on electricity, on different things. I was very powerful one time. I can make decisions. They're very important. A lot of number of people are affected by my decisions. But it's all automatically changed all over the night. Just because technology has come, new technology is available. People have different options, and my power has come down. So basically, it focuses on those decisions made by government or non-government actors. For what? To address a problem that a significant number of people and groups consider to be important. Then only I feel important. Then only I feel powerful and in need of a solution. When we are studying policy, we are studying some of these dynamics. That's why I brought this slide. Policy making is all about all about decision making, looking at who holds the power, how are they using power, how are they making those decisions. Those decisions are benefiting whom or not benefiting. So when we are getting into this, we are already analyzing a policy. So I will not talk about this a little bit more. You can go on and read, maybe if you're interested, because this is a very interesting thing. Power, politics, for political science, I think these are the very basics, right? From Plato to Aristotle, they looked at this power, politics, how this power and politics play important in a state formation or state building. So I will skip this slide. I'll also skip this, but I just want to tell you this. This is what happened. Many thinkers, philosophers have done a lot of contributions to our understanding of power, how, you know, this exchange of power takes place between individuals, between families, groups, communities, countries, nations, different governments, you know. There's a lot of things that we can learn from there. But the point here is, when you want to analyze a policy, you are trying to understand how this power play comes into, you know, your picture, how you can understand this, you know, what we mean by power, I think is important there. Okay, as I said, there are two ways that you can analyze the policy. At least there are many ways, but in today we will discuss about two ways. There are people who think policy making is linear, just like this. I'll show you a picture. There are other people who think that no, it's not linear, it's a process. We already discussed what is process. That means it is complex, it's cyclic, or it is up and down, or it is not linear. What do you think? Policy making is linear, just, you know, starts from here and ends there. Just step by step. There are other people think that, no, policy making is not that linear, it's very complex, very, you know, up and down. So there are a lot of things, you know, come into picture. So it's not that clear line. What is your opinion? Or there must be a third way, you know, to understand policy making. It's linear and it's also process-oriented, complex. Or there may be a fourth way to understand. What is your understanding about policy making in Malaysia or any other country? In our university, how policies are being made? Is it linear? Is it complex? Is it both? Is it top-down? Is it bottom-up? It's horizontal? Or is it vertical? What do you think? In NGOs, for example, what kind of policy making you see? In the NGOs that you're working, or your organization, your teacher training, whatever, Ministry of Health, JKM, a friend is here. What kind of policy making you see in JKM? Is it top down? Have you ever contributed to any policy?
So for her, it is top down and bottom up, okay?
And And in your case, is it linear, is it complex? Can we put one word to that process? It's linear. Okay. It's linear because you as an NGO had some idea, you had some experience, and you believe this is right, and then you just tell them, oh, I don't know what you did, and they have changed. So it's still linear. Okay, it started from you, it went to, what is that body you said? JP. Sports Community Development, and from there it went to
the Penang government,
and it's went to the federal. Okay, it's still very linear.
Not federal, it's
only
for.
Okay, still, whatever. It started from here, it ended there. So you think it's linear? Okay. What is any other? What is the song? People are saying it's linear, it is process, it's that, it's But when we see on the ground, we don't see all that happening there. There is a gap. And it is inevitable.
That's how, you know, I think we see there is always a need for new knowledge production. For that, you know, the practice will be improved. Social work. 200 years, we have knowledge. A lot of people work, a lot of methods been evolved, casework, group work, community organization. These methods were not there 200 years ago. So all these methods have been, you know, kind of invented or built over 200 years by many social workers. So social work knowledge is rich, it's everywhere. A lot of people contributed to that. But when it comes to the ground, maybe you know, we only see a little bit of that. We are not able to translate the whole thing to the ground. Maybe it's not possible also.
So it's a gap between the policy and implementation.
Policy knowledge.
Policy knowledge.
And the way it is implemented.
Yeah.
You got this point, I think very important. Even as a social worker, 2 years, you have a lot of things. But when you go to an NGO, you don't have all the opportunities to implement what you know. So there is a gap there. Or there is social work knowledge available and you don't know all that in it. And the practice that you do, and there's always a room for improvement. So the gap between knowledge, say policy knowledge, and policy practice, the way policies are made and how policies can be best made. Okay, let me put this way there. This is how we made our policies. Now, for example, Malaysia policy or your health policy, we made this. We encouraged medical tourism, we encouraged Malaysia One clinics, so there's so many things. The ways policies are made, this is how we made. But what are the best way it can be? There must be another way, you know. It's not the only thing that is happening now. Last 50, 60 years, the policies keep changing. That means there's another best way to do this, waiting. So the way policies are being made, and how policies can be the best made. There's always a tension there. You can see that gap. You look at your own breastfeeding, you know, policy. If it is very good, there's nothing need to be done, there's no need, there's no work for you.
Yes, I know.
Yeah. Because you see a lot of gaps, a lot of obstacles, a lot of limitations in that, you're trying to contribute to that. So it's always, you know, you will find some limitations because the society is changing. There are new needs are coming. There's new technologies coming. It's always changing. So the policy will never be able to solve, you know, any particular problem. So you see there's a lot of gap always. That is what the knowledge and practice gap. By discussing this, we are trying to contribute to this. You agree or not? Otherwise, we don't need to discuss what is linear, what is, you know, process, what is cyclic, you know, what is top-down, what is bottom, what do we need to discuss? Anyway, the gap will be there, despite of our discussion. So why do we need to discuss? But our aim is to reduce that gap, otherwise the gap may increase. So our aim is to reduce that gap. To reduce the gap, what are we trying to do? How are we doing? How we can reduce that gap? For example, there is gap between rich and poor. How do we try to fill that gap? Rich and poor, right? How do we reduce that gap? You agree there is a gap?
Yes.
How do we try to reduce that gap or eliminate that gap or bridge that gap? What do we do?
By taking some money from the rich and poor.
Okay, by taking some money from rich, give it to poor. Okay, what else? That is one way. Okay, you are trying to fill that gap.
So that's how the policy comes in. Policy
Coming. What else? What are the other ways? Okay, you take some little bit money, give it to the poor. And then, what I would say, I will create more earning opportunities for poor so that they will also earn. I don't take money from the rich. That is another way. What else? I can also make the rich poor by bringing, you know, some hard policy that they don't earn anymore and they also become poor. Possible? Huh? So no one is rich, so I'm happy, I can rule them. That's possible. There are many policies reduce literacy in developing countries. You know why do they do that? Politicians? They talk about education, this and that, but there's so many policies reduce literacy opportunities. They don't want their people to become literate, so that they will not argue, they will not ask for questions. There's so many, this is politics of policy, we'll go there. So what I'm trying to do is, we are trying to reduce the gap in different ways, the rich and poor, the same thing here. So there's always a gap between the real policy knowledge and the way we practice it. So what we're trying to do is, we're trying to fill that gap by whatever analysis we do, by linear, or process, or cycling, top down, whatever you call it, we're trying to do the best policy. Agree? Shall we move on? Okay, this is what linear. If you believe that social policy is all about a linear, this is how it looks like. I'm taking it from the, you can read that word. Birklan, an introduction to the policy process. You take any literature, they'll show this diagram. What is there? There is an issue, okay? And then there is something called agenda setting. There's something called alternative selection, enactment, implementation, evaluation. And again, issue. It could be anything. Basically, there is a problem, say human trafficking. Then it becomes agenda of the government or the priority issue for the government. And then it becomes, what are the alternatives? And then they enact and it's implemented. They also evaluate. If the results are not good, it goes again. It's very simple. You can use any words. Maybe from the beginning it's a problem analysis. Then you implement the policy. Then you see the results. And then again you revise. Very simple. But is that? And initially people believed in this. This is how the whole analysis being made in 1930s, 20s or whatever. But later they started questioning, is that simple? A lot of policy studies took place, but on the ground, people are still poor. Human trafficking is still happening. You know, people are suffering with a lot of diseases. Even now, a good policy, Malaysia one is a good policy, but still there are inequities. Why? Last 50 years, Malaysia is doing very well in terms of poverty. But still there are 3% of people are still poor. Why? Because implementation, okay. One is implementation. Even implementation is damn good, okay. Now you have achieved 97%. How come you are not able to achieve that 3%? You would have not achieved that 97% if the implementation is a problem. What else? What would have been the reason? Still there are poor. You can't change them, they want to be poor. Or your policy is still missing somewhere. Something is missing. So earlier they thought this. Okay, we have a beautiful, you know, poverty policy. Then it became an agenda of the government. There were a lot of resources spent on that. They've also tried to find out what are the alternative selections or alternative measures. They have taken that. They have enacted, there are legislations, there are programs, they've implemented it for 50, 60 years now, they've evaluated, again still there are this 3% of the people are still, you know, poor, homeless. The government is working, maybe one day we will have, 100% or whatever. So this is the linear thinking, it's called linear thinking. This is an issue, these are the things we have done, and this is how it is enacted, and this is how it is implemented. And these are the supposed to be the results, and there is an evaluation, again this comes. Very one by one, step by step. But there are other people, like you and me, if this is working, why there are still human trafficking issues? Why still there are poor people? Why still, you know, there are people with homeless? Why there are still, you know, people with a lot of health issues? They started asking that question, and they come to this picture now. Policy making is not that linear, but it is, our friend said cyclic, whatever. So we need to understand that way so that we can still improve our policy so that it will catch even the 3% people.
So what they said, the words could be very different. If you see literature, people say agenda setting, people say problem analysis or problem identification, whatever. Set the agenda, then you formulate a policy, then you adapt that policy, then you implement that policy, then you evaluate that, and there are revisions. There is a revision, there could be another formulation, there could be a, you know. So what is the difference between this and that? It looks very simple, very, very similar, right? Even here they are saying that, you know, you implement all that, you evaluate, and you go there. So this is also saying that, okay, you evaluate, you revise. What is the difference? It's nothing. It's only a diagram, or there is any basic difference between these two.
Political issues,
policy making, institutions, legislature, executive, courts, bureaucracy, policy, expenditures, taxes, laws, regulations, non-decisions, people, impacts. There are three steps. Political issues, get onto the political agenda, then it becomes policy, makers name the policy, and policies affect people. What is this? Client, tell us.
Process.
Process, okay. What else? A deception, a depiction of how citizens are affected by the by and influence policy. Citizens, people. How policies affect people, how people
influence
policies.
So it's,
can we get that from this picture?
Yes.
It's bottom up and also top down. What she said, we can see in her take and this is how it happens. I don't know, we'll see. What else we get from this? People, interests, problems, and concerns. What is that? Sorry?
Their needs.
Okay, there are different kinds of people. There are rich, there are poor, there are semi-rich, there are middle income, there are higher income, there are middle income. You know, we can go on like that, okay? And they have their interests, you know, the rich, the industrialists, the academics, the researchers, the media. I mean, I think maybe how many? 13 million people? We have 13 million disabled, gays, Muslims, you know, race. You know, I mean, do you think we can ever understand people? We are social workers. We are supposed to understand that.
Yeah.
It's not just one homogeneous entity. It's very interesting. That's why, you know, social work or social policy. In your career, how many people you would meet as a social worker? Have you ever thought about that? Now you have to think. You know, now that you've got into this business, in the next maybe you are 20, 25 now. Another 40 years. In 40 years, what kind of people you will meet? How do you understand their interests? How many people you can help? Any idea? Any numbers that you think now?
Few
thousands. Few thousands? Okay. You think you will never influence this 30 million people? Is possible?
Yes.
Yes? How? You bring such a policy that it affects all 30 million people. Why not?
You become
Prime Minister, I don't know, Secretary to the Prime Minister. It's actually Secretary to the Prime Minister who is powerful, not the Prime Minister. We can also talk about that. So people, interests, problems and concerns. Okay, we try and understand that. And it goes to linkages, institutions, parties, elections, media and interest groups. We can add more. What is that? Connection between people and these institutions. Okay, let me go ahead. Maybe we will land up here on. See, we are thinking about policy making process. Some people thought that policies are like this. Some people are thinking that policies are like this. So to understand that knowledge, you know, you have a piece of knowledge now. It's a linear process and it's cyclic. How do we understand these two things into this? It's also looking like a cycle, but it's not completed. There's still a gap there. Why there is a gap there? Have anyone thought? Why there is a gap there? That fellow Edwards, when he's trying to, you know, present his idea, he kept a gap there, there's an arrow mark there. Why is that? How you would have done this? This is what I want you to develop, the critical analysis. Don't take picture just like that. Immediately, what is this? What is this arrow looking at there? Why there is a gap in between? If this could have been like this also, just one line. Why, you know, it is in round shape? What is this connection? It makes any sense now? If you ask those questions?
I feel like it should join.
It should join, okay. You feel why? To me, he is trying to tell us there is always a gap. We can always connect this, take it, you know, nearer, whatever, or you can, you know, even do this.
maybe there's still gap, you know. People impact policies, the way impact policies, there's still a gap. They could have been better. The impact would have been much higher, but it's not happening.
So
maybe it's trying to tell us there is a gap. It's a gap. They're not able to influence, or there's somehow they're still, you know, left out. I don't know whose fault is that. Maybe they themselves are at fault, or you and me, or the policymakers. Why is that we are not able to cover those 3%? Very simple, just 3%. Identify them, give every, you know, every month 500 ringgits, finished. Malaysia, there's no poverty. But we are not able to identify them. Each time you identify, the new numbers are coming. What else we can understand is, political issues get on to the political agenda. What is this agenda building? Here, you can see here also, right? There is something called agenda setting. There is something called agenda setting here also. What is this agenda setting? When we are analyzing a policy, we are trying to understand a policy, what is this agenda setting? What is an agenda? Who sets these agendas? There is a meeting, there is an agenda, right? Who sets that? Maybe the president or the secretary or the executive board. For Malaysia, maybe it is the prime minister and his cabinet. For USM, it is the vice chancellor and deputy vice chancellors. What is this agenda? Why people, you know, talk about agendas? Very important again when it comes to policy. Huh? Sorry?
Vision.
Agenda setting is all about vision. Okay. Strategic planning, goals. Priorities, needs. That means we need to set the agenda. Any policy you take,
yes,
there is an agenda setting or agendas in place. Okay, 100% we want to, you know, make Malaysia a rich place, no poor anymore. It was not there before. Suddenly, why do we need that? What is the reason behind this story? The story behind the story. There is a vision behind that. There is a necessity behind that. There is some evidence behind that. So anyone saying one Malaysia, it's a story. And you get suddenly, you know, a piece of information. Maybe a little different, but we all know what it is. In policy that happens. If you're a good storyteller, come up with something like that. Okay, you know, social welfare, or we care. Something like that. I don't know what is the new website. Something like that. So the moment we say you care, we care, oh, it's JKM and this is their vision. A story behind that. So it helps you to understand the policy. If you're a good policy maker, you should be a storyteller. Or if you're a good policy analyst, you should be able to understand the stories within the stories. For example, getting the prices right. Economists, you know, most of the time they use this World Bank terminology. They say all the time, our policy is that we want to get the price right. What do you mean by that? In India, garibi hatao. I don't know whether you know Hindi. In Indira Gandhi, there's another prime minister, she came up with this word called garibi hatao. Garibi is poverty, hatao is remove. Remove poverty, and she became a prime minister in that slogan. And in India, people also think that social work is all about roti, kapada or makan. Roti, kapada and makan. Roti is food, kapada is clothing, makan is the house. Social work is all about roti, kapada and makan, not about makan. Malaysia makan is food anyway. So social work all about this, just one line, story. Also, roti, kapada or makan. Three basics. A good story. When anyone using this, there is a story. So how do we understand that story? Is your ability now? How do we understand stories? It's very easy, right? Stories. What does a story tell me? A story has a beginning and an end. There are a lot of twists and turns. Conflicts, this and that, some friction, this and that. There's so many. It's very easy to understand from right now, from as a children we like stories. It's a message, and then there is a moral. There are policy analysts or policy researchers or policy makers. make their policies through stories. And we can see that. So when you want to analyze a particular policy, you see that. What kind of story is this? What kind of story behind this policy? Whether it's education policy, education for all. It will never happen. But you know, still they'll say that education for all. Beautiful story. How nice is that? So there is one way to understand policies is to understand the stories. And in another word, it's called narratives. I don't know how, what is the Malaysian thing? Narrative. You narrate things. Once upon a time, there was a king. He has 10 children. And all the 10 children became, you know, nice and beautiful, you know, the Barbie stories, you see. There is a story. There is a, you know, beautiful message. We, you know, looking at the society, looking at the, you know, interest of the reader. There's so many things. Story writing is not that easy. Policies are like that.
So I
can tell that policy is like story. It is. I mean, if you're a good Ronald Reagan or Bill Clinton, they have stories. Even Obama, he has a story about his role about policies. He tells stories. So this is one way to analyze. Just, you know, what is the story behind this policy? You ask this question, a lot of things come there. Who is telling this story? For whom? What is the message of this story? What is the hidden story? Look at that. I mean, it's just one catch word, storytelling. And you will get into, you know, these interesting things. There are counter narratives. There are narratives and there are counter narratives. One Malaysia policy, nonsense, nothing is there. It's three Malaysia policy. Counter narratives. There are people who are making counter stories. It's called counter narratives. As a policy analyst, you also have to understand that. What is the story? What is the counter story? You just do this, you will be able to analyze the policy. Nothing else you need. Just one word. What is the story? What is the message? Who made this story? For whom? What are the twists? And what are the counter stories? You will be able to analyze. It's a qualitative analysis. Just one framework. Like that, there are networkers. Or networking. Policy is all about networking. What do we mean by that? There is no net if there is no work. Policy is all about work. So many people contribute, there's so many, you know, interests. Being inside the tent or outside the tent. What is that? Either you're inside or you're outside. If you're a good networking person, if you're working on a health policy, you tend to network with similar kind of people. You want to be very close to the health minister. You want to be very close to the doctors. You want to be very close to the hospitals. You want to be very close to the mothers. You want to be very close to the, you know, clients. You are networking with people who has similar interest. You are a health policy activist. You are networking with me, you know, educational people. Maybe there is some reason, but still, your immediate network will be with who? Your same interest people. For example, you are very close to the Ministry of Secretary, or Secretary of the Home Ministry or whatever. You'll be able to influence. You have done very good study, but you don't have any networking. You can't even reach, you know, Putrajaya. What, you know, policy making you can do. So policy making, policy analysis is all about networking. It could be another way to look at, you know, policy. You don't know about stories, for example. You don't know about counter stories. Forget about that. You know networking. Then you start, who are all the big players in this policy? Who is networking with whom? How is this networking taking place? How I can network with? If I really want to influence this policy, with whom all I should network, build a network, so that I can influence with this. Another way to understand policy, simple. Very simple. You want to work on, what is that, the human, donation, organ donations. You want to understand the policy. Whom all you want to network with? You will not network with me because I don't want to donate my organs. There's no point. You can still talk to me why you are not, you know, donating. You can still talk to me. But your first network is with the people who wants to donate or already donated or already, you know, the organs received and, you know, surviving and already doctors or hospitals where this is happening. or that that what is that Malaysia human organ, you know, one federation or something like that.
Yeah.
Huh? These are the people you want to network with, not with any XYZ. Then you are wasting your resources. You are not moving. So if I want to analyze, you're still sleeping? No. You want to close?
Shall we a little bit decrease?
It's too cold for him, but you guys are already, you know, heated up.
Yeah.
So we'll see. It will be okay. Or you want to come this side?
Maybe.
You see where you want to sit. So, I'm talking about network. So, this is another way to understand. You agree or not? You want to analyze human organ donation policy. Either look at the stories, like, you know, cultural, you know, if you donate your eye, next month you don't have, you will not have eyes. There's a story. There are certain people saying that. They're promoting that, you know. And who are these people promoting this? Why are they promoting? What evidence they have? Look at that. You're getting into analysis. You're not using computers. You're not using any, you know, SPSS statistical packages. But you are analyzing. This is a qualitative analysis. Later I will explain about quantitative analysis. Networking will be another, you know, spectacle which will help you to analyze. Engineers. Who is an engineer? Social workers are social engineers. Social workers are known as social engineers. What is engineering? And there is reverse engineering. Engineering and reverse engineering. Chinese are good in reverse engineering. You know what is reverse engineering? What is engineering?
Tailoring.
Okay. You build something. You know, you put so many things together and make it work. And reverse engineering is remove all the parts and try to understand and then again fix it again. You don't invent or you don't discover. Someone does this for you and you take that, you remove all the parts one by one, and then try and understand how it works and you do it yourself. Reverse engineering. You know, you just copy, you know, from there, but again you make it work. Engineers. Policy is what policy does. We also discussed at the beginning. And street level bureaucrats are the two keywords here. For example, you want to understand the same thing, the health donation policy. Whom all you want to talk to or interview, or I don't know what you do. Any idea?
The officers.
The officers, okay. Okay, the officers, what else?
The receiver.
The donors. The minister, the doctor, the nurse, the family members of the donor. You interview all of them, but you invariably forget one important person. Who is that?
The person who donates.
The person who donates also you will discuss. You will start with that. But someone else you will forget. Well, who is that? Who that could be? Family also you will talk. Remember that engineering thing. Brain engineering and reverse engineering. That's what most of the time happens, it seems. You make it traffic policy, but you will never consult the traffic police who's sitting on the road. You will never consult him. But that fellow is the one who actually implements the traffic policy. It's not the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Traffic. Or if a traffic minister comes to you, where is your license? Show me. Who is asking that? The one who is sitting on the road, you know, or driving on that bike. But we will never consult with them. If you're an engineer, you will talk even to them. And those are the ones, street level bureaucrats. Very small person in the link. Most of the time we forget them. We don't put them in our big model. But then it's like a chip in your mobile, you know. Chip is very important, very small thing, but it's very important. So if you want to really understand a policy, understand all those small players. So when it comes to your organ donation, who will be that small player that you will forget to interview?
doctor who's...
The doctor also you will interview. He's a big guy. You know, how can you forget him?
Suggested.
You're coming close. People?
Suggested.
To me, that small guy is that broker. Most of the time, we forget that fellow. You know? Or it could be anyone else. You know, the broker who motivates you to sell, or who motivates you to it could be a social worker, you know, sometimes. But we don't, you know. We may interview social workers, but we may forget to, you know, interview those community, you know, brokers or whatever you call it. Or we may forget to interview the person who is cleaning the ward or changing the beds. Also tells, you know, stories. Oh, this is very difficult. Why you gave? You know, if you gave like this, you know, you will not, you know, they will tell there, and then people will believe. They influence a lot. Even our religion gurus. I don't know. I mean, the point here is, if you're a good engineer, a policy engineer, you will not even forget that small part, that small screw, that small, you know, conductor, whatever you call it. So, this is another way to understand a policy. You don't know stories, you don't know network, you only know engineering. So first you'll identify all these important parts, small parts, you know, maybe it's like, you know, knowing your work very well. What are the parts that you need to make a radio to function, a mobile to function? Even the smallest of the smallest, you know, things, especially those street level bureaucrats who actually implements the policy. It is they who ensure a policy is implemented or not. For example, you have to have a helmet, otherwise you are fined. That is the policy. The traffic police is not implementing that. He is not interested. Okay, you have put the helmet, you don't put the helmet, he doesn't care. What happens? Do we put the helmet? We will never put the helmet. Because without putting the helmet also, you are not fined, you are not getting caught. Because that fellow is, okay, he's leaving it just like that. So actually, who is then implementing influencing policy? It is the person who is standing on the road, on the traffic. He is the one who is supervising, who is influencing whether that particular policy is implemented or not. So those are the important people that we need to interview.
So is it engineer?
You are an engineer. I'm talking about you. You are the policy editor, the social worker. Yeah. You want to be a storyteller, or you want to be a networker, you want to act like an engineer, or at the end I have another set of people here who are for fixes.
So act like
a you might use all of them, or you might take one particular preference when it comes to policy analysis. So when it comes to policy analysis, you may prefer storytelling. You analyze a particular policy, looking at the stories, inside stories, who is telling the story for whom and all that. That is one way of analyzing the policy. You might be using networking, or you are a networker, you believe in networking, you know what is how networking takes place, you know, all that. That could be one way to understand, analyze. Or you might be an engineer kind of person who will analyze policy from that particular angle. Like an engineer, you know, all the parts, you know, all that. And then you might be a fixer. I mean, these are the words in policy language they use. So it's better that you also know the same words. So anytime you are studying a policy document and you see these words, then you can connect. So knowing these policy terms also very important when it comes to analysis. So there are these fixers. Knowing when to make your pitch and to whom. Think about your source of power. You said you could influence. How you have done that? Maybe you are there. You are trying to fix. You can fix things. You know where to, you know, move the cards with whom. And if you could do that, basically you are that kind of person. That also helps you to understand. Okay, in medical tourism, how this policy came? How this medical tourism policy came? Who must have brought? Is it Indonesian government? Is it within the Malaysian government? Is it private medical hospitals? Maybe yes. It is the private medical hospitals encouraging medical tourism. Maybe. Because they know, you know, that is where the money is. That is where they can charge any amount of money because they are not Malaysians. They know, you know, this is another revenue stream for the funding the hospitals. And to do that, what they must have done? They must have lobbied with the Ministry of Health. They must have lobbied with the Ministry of, you know, Indonesian embassies. They must have lobbied with many groups, media, economists,
alliance.
They fixed the story, you know, they know where to fix what. And now medical tourism policy is in place. That is one way of analyzing it. So you can use any method. You can be a storyteller, you can be a networking person, you can be an engineer, you can be a fixing person. Use any of these things, you will be able to analyze. What do you think? Does it make sense now? It's very simple. No statistics, no SPSS, no complicated equations. But what do you think? Is that helpful now? People think policy analysis is very difficult, but it's not. You can use this in your term papers and see what happens. Just use one of this. I want to understand your medical donor thing. For that you need some tools. Use one of this. You will go very, very in depth. You have to start somewhere. That is what analysis.
So basically these four things explain
intervention, triggering, whatever you call it. Just one tool, just say one tool. You can use all four of them. It will become a beautiful story. Find out what are the stories behind this policy. Find out what are the narratives, what are the counter narratives. Okay, one page. Then you find out what are the networking happening. Who are the networkers here? Who are the main players? With whom they network? How they network? All these questions. It becomes another, you know, important analysis. Then you talk about this engineering, you know. Who are these people who are actually, you know, powerful in implementing a policy? Is it the medical person, or is it a nurse, or is it a religious person? You know, it gives you another way to analyze. You see the difference between these things? They are different, you know. One, there is a sunglass, there is a, you know, night vision glass, there is a 10 plus, you know, there are different specs. If it is night, you put the night, you know, vision glass, so you can see. So use this, you will be able to analyze. Maybe we'll stop here. And any questions? It looks very simple, but when we use, you go into really details. For example, even to find out the fixing thing, it's not easy. Who fixes what? And at what time you will fix? To fix what kind of power you will use. For example, there are physical power, there are resources power, there are position power, expert power, personal power, and negative power. What is negative power? Can you guess? We talked about power, right? You can use that in that to understand who fixes. Negative power. I can stop things, negative power. I can stop this, you know, class not happening very well. You know, negative power. You know, some disturbances all the time, you know. I can stop, you know, a particular policy not to come because it will affect me. For example, your lottery policy. I can stop because I found another lottery which is more, you know, online or something like that. Negative power. You know? If it is, but I give you that lottery thing. We know it's not good, right? But it's still happening. Why? Someone is fixing somewhere so that it's still continuing. Find out who is that fixing, you know, person behind. How he or she or that company is able to, you know, continue in this lottery thing. Just ask that question, you get into many things. Well, how that lottery thing is going on? Any idea? Who wants that? A four-digit lottery. We are social workers, right? We are very much interested in lottery. I see every day, you know, in my thing, there are two things. Weekends, they're full. People are losing money. I have not seen not even one person smiling there. last 8 months. 8 months, every Saturday I go there, spend some 10 minutes like this, you know, just buying something else. Not even one person, you know, oh, hooray, I got it. No, I've not seen any smiling face there. So as social worker, we know it is very, very, you know, bad for the people. But we are not able to stop maybe. I don't know, maybe we can stop. If you can understand what kind of power, who is using what power. Position power. I'm in a position. I'm the secretary to the prime minister. I can advise him. Look, I say, this is the time you have to stop this. You will get a lot of votes, you know. I'm the imam of the mosque which prime minister comes. I can use my position power. Resource power. I have a lot of land where you can build you another twin tower. Now that's opposite to the, I have a position, resources. So when you're talking about fixing people, people have different powers and they use that power to fix that particular policy. Find out that. Who is using negative power, who is using fixing, who is that? So when you use this, you are getting into the nitty-gritties of policy. Otherwise, how do we analyze policy? Not just computers. No. After all, you have to feed information, even simulation, whatever. Policies, we can also analyze by simulation. Okay, now 200 people in Penang are playing lottery. If I put a lot of incentives, maybe by 2015, this 2000 will become 200,000. How do I make simulation? Okay, in which area I have to promote a lot? You know the Tesco card? What do they do with that information? You know that? Tesco card, the membership card. By signing the Tesco form, you're actually signing that, okay, you can use my information.
Yes.
Yes. It's not that, they're giving you that voucher just like that.
Yes.
So they analyze the data. Okay, this month, how much is the Dutch lady milk is being sold? Who is buying? At what intervals they're buying? Okay, per month, okay, this is the demand. Okay, next time. They make a lot of calculations out of the data. And they make policy changes. Then the next month, okay, there is free. The next month they will do something. The next, our data is being used. Without the card, they can't take the data.
Yes.
They can still take the data, how much is being sold, but they will not be able to find out the consumer's preference.
Yes.
So by introducing that, Tesco card policy, they're actually finding consumer preferences, consumer behavior, buying patterns. There's so many things that you can do that. It's analysis. So these are some of the ways that you can analyze a policy. And there are other ways to do this. This is just one way. I'll stop. Okay, this is one way. This we will do when you come back. This is another way. This is another way. This is another way. And this is another way. And this is another way. If you know these 5-6 ways, you will become experts. If you want, we can discuss other ways. I'll just introduce one more level of analysis and we can stop there. There's no problem. You don't need to learn all this. But if you really want to become good policy analyst, maybe you have to learn all of that. Because you will be in that position. You're analyzing policies. And if your analytical skills are better, you will be, you will be promoted much faster, actually. Because after all, policy analysis is an important thing. Now, how do you analyze? You need certain tools. And these are the tools that people are using in social work and social policy. If you're an economist, you would have used different tools. Since you're a social worker, social policy, these are some of the tools that social policy people are using. If you're interested, you are welcome after 5-10 minutes. Let's have a break. So in the next 1 hour, we will spend maybe some of these models. And last half an hour, you guys will present your case studies and then we'll conclude. The next one is very easy, don't worry. Just release 2-3 models and that's it.
The first one we
talked
about the policy, what is a policy? The two sorts of the policy, which is linear and also process. And you see three types of model. The first one is linear, the second one is this one, and then the second one is circular, and the third one is also circular, but
which is the first one is narrative. Second one is networkers. The third one is engineers, and the last one is fixers.
Okay. Thank you very much. We are trying to understand what is this policy analysis, what are the types, or what are the schools of thought, and we somehow, I think, more or less understood this linear thinking and this cyclic thinking, and we also introduced a little bit how do we analyze policy, whether it is linear, whether it is cyclic, whether it is top-down or bottom-up or vertical, whatever it is, how do we analyze this? One way to analyze this is to stories, networking, fixing, and then engineering. That one, you know, framework, one tool, whatever you call it, will help you to start, you know, analyzing, start understanding, start looking policy in depth, you know, or much more critical, whatever you call it. There's another. Another way is to look at is CDAE. This is another very simple tool if you want to use. You can see context, evidence, links, and external environment. Four keywords to start analyzing a particular policy area. What is the context? In which context this policy is being implemented? Who implemented? Which government is implementing, the main implementing agency, the context. Is it 1930s or is it 1950s or is it 1990s or is it 2010? You know, the time. In which time this particular policy is being implemented, the context behind this. For whom? Is it for Malays? Is it for everyone? Is it for disabled? Is it for elders? Is it for women? You know, you can write a little context. In which this particular policy is implemented. Is it only for Sabah and Sarawak, or is it for every state? Is it only for Penang? In the context, we try to understand the context. Then the evidence. What evidence we have to say particular things about this policy. Okay, this policy is very good. This policy is doing very well. It has achieved its targets, or it is yielding its objectives, whatever. You know, it is achieving its mission, vision, whatever it is, and it's doing very well. You know, there's some evidence that we can collect. What evidence? Maybe from, again, from different sources, from media, from reports, from bureaucrats, from NGOs, from civil society. Wherever you can collect evidence, you can collect from the stakeholders, from the clients, from the, you know, wherever you can collect some evidence, you can collect evidence to prove or disprove how a particular policy is doing, then what links it has with other organizations. You remember vertical policies and horizontal policies. What links it has with other ministries, other line agencies, other NGOs, other funding donor agencies. You know, what links, what kind of links does this policy, you know, trying to link up with or already linked up with? What external environment are influencing? Is it World Bank? Or is it ADB, or is it federally funded, or what is the external environment is trying to influence this particular policy? If you can understand these four key words, the context in which it is being formulated or implemented, the evidence that you can collect to approve or disprove a particular policy targets or achievements, or the links and the external environment that is, you know, that is being influenced. If you can understand these little things, you can still will be able to say that this is how this particular policy is, you know, doing now or being implemented, or these are the mid-course corrections that are required. You can say something. I mean, this is one way to analyze. What do you think about this? Is it easy? Or you can add more actually. You know, why only this four? Why not more? Why not more? What else we can add? What else we can add to this? Just a first level of analysis, like your storytelling, your, you know, engineering, you know. This is just one way to look at what is the context. Even to understand the context, what are the things that we need to know? Okay, time frame, what else? Place, geography, what else? Context. which this particular which is the main implementing agencies for this particular policy? For example, juvenile justice, juvenile policy. Which context, in which time it has been prepared, by whom, which government, which ministry is responsible, after that which ministry is responsible. What else we can collect? The context. How many, you know, people it is covering? What is the, you know, achievements till now? Context. Very simple. But if you want to write, it can become 20 pages. Rest on context. Maybe this particular policy is being implemented last 10 years, two economic policies, two planning periods. In the first 2 years, it has done like this. In the next 4 years, it has done like this. But last 2 years, it's something like this. You can cover time, geography, client, target group, agency. There's so many things that we can bring in there, don't you think? Context. In which context this particular thing is, you know. So that could be one way to get into this. What evidence we have for the achievements it's claiming? Same, the poverty. People are saying it's only 3%. They're all quoting 3%. What is the evidence for that? Maybe it is more than 3%. Maybe it's 5%. Maybe it's 10%. It's like your poverty calculations. How many people are poor? But what is the poverty line calculations? If you use $1 a day, if you're not earning a dollar, American dollar, that means 3 ringgits, you are poor. Another way to assess poverty is the calorie intake. If you are not taking 3,000 kilocalories, then you are poor. The basic, you know, living, I think you require something like that. If you are not taking that much calorie food, then that means you are poor. That is another way to assess poverty. There are so many, you know, ways to assess. And each tool or each approach might give you a different statistics. So this 3% abject poor, who is saying this? Is it Ministry of Economics? Or is it Ministry of Planning? Or who is saying this? What is the evidence for this? Maybe an NGO report saying that, you know, it's more. So collect the evidence from different sources. Same, your organ, you know, human organ donation. The one report says 14,000 people, you know, are already given. What is the gap? Maybe, you know, you collect from the hospitals, you collect from different sources. Then you will be able to say, cross-triangulate the evidence that you collect. Then what links with which other organizations? And what are the external environment that is influencing? For example, you're working on climate change policy. So what are the things that you need to look at? The climate change policy of Malaysia, you're studying that. Okay, this is the context. Okay, you're studying this climate change policy between, say, 2000 to 2012. Whole of Malaysia, and then you have evidence. Okay, it's warming up. You know, the sea levels are rising. You know, so you have some evidence to say that. You know, and then the government initiatives implemented in the last 5 years shows that, you know, the air emissions or whatever, you know, are under control or there is improvement. Collect some evidence to talk about whether for or against. You say that, okay, global change is not working, Malaysia, you collect the evidence. It is working, you collect the evidence. Whatever you say, you collect the evidence. We can't just say like that, you know. This is where we are getting into the analysis. What links it has with the COP, you know, what is it, Copenhagen, what is it? COP, the Commission on, there's something that, there's so many organizations working on this. What is the carbon emissions? What is the carbon footprint? This one. When you read about climate change, there are a lot of things that are happening. Even to produce one cup of coffee, you need 80 liters of water or something like that. So they're saying that you reduce your water consumption. So that the, you know, there's so many arguments, so many evidence, so many links that you can put together.
So when you say links, is it related to the agencies or any
bodies? Agencies, bodies, you know, any links that you can explore. For example, say, climate change policy in Malaysian climate change policy is working. You want to prove that, you have evidence. And you have collected that evidence from the World Bank reports, from the ADB reports, from the World Wildlife Fund reports, your own government reports, maybe some NGO working on, you know, their reports. You collect all the evidence, and by basically, you know, you're showing the links already and the external environment. So you can see that, you know, there's many ways that you can collect this information, link it together and say at the end, okay, look, I've seen all this, I've looked at the context, I've looked at the evidence, I've explored the links, and these are the external environment things I also have taken into consideration. By saying all this, yes, it's working. Okay, I can say that, I can see that it's working. The emission levels are coming down. No, the government reports are wrong. Look, they are contradicting. You know, they're constructing the data. One report they say 2.4, another report they say 2.3, another report they say 2.7, they themselves are confused. So how can they say that it's working? Whatever you come up with, this is simple, silly. Context, evidence, networks and links, external environment. So how is this different from your storytelling, the other slide that I showed you? For example, you're using the storytelling. So how do you do this? For example, you're using the storytelling thing, and would the material be very different from this, or it will be the same?
Different.
Same? Not different.
Different.
Different. How? For example, you are using storytelling, yeah, to understand the climate change policy. What kind of material you would have collected compared to this? Different, I agree with that, but how it is different? You are with me? I'm asking, for example, I've shown you two slides now. This is Selly framework, you know? Context. What is that? So this is one thing. And there is something called storytelling, engineering, fixing. So tomorrow you are trying to analyze. Okay, I want to analyze, you know, climate change policy. So these two slides come to you. So which one you will use and how?
Because
the earlier one talks more about the intervention of the policies. And this one?
It's about analyzing the policy.
And that one?
How
we are going to come out with the policy, whereas this, it's already been implemented. You know, that one you can also use for the analysis. Not only for formulating but also analysis, that's what I mean. How? Okay. We'll come to this question a little later. Now just keep it there. I'll show you one more. Okay, this is very simple. You will find it not confusing at all, this one. This is very easy. This is called force field analysis.
So which means this? The CDAE is number one.
You can give number five also. I just showed number one because it's easier. Just simple. Write one paragraph about the context, one paragraph about the, what is that?
Evidence.
What evidence you have, one paragraph about the links, one paragraph about the external factors. Finished. Your paper looks very analytical. What we are trying to do is, how do we analyze this thing called policy? So you have written little bit context, little written bit about evidence, a little written bit about links, and little. Become a nice paper, look, my midterm paper. You can publish in a newspaper. Believe me, you can publish in a newspaper. You write these four steps, you send it to a newspaper. If they don't publish, ask me. Just write that this is the framework that I'm using. Using this framework, this is this. Just write one page, send it to them. If they don't publish, ask me. Then we should. Then we can we can further discuss. Makes sense. It's in the literature. People have used this method. Believe me. You don't need to believe me, but you do it, and then if it works, then you believe. People have done this. So it works. It makes sense. You've written a context. You've written, you know, the links. You have written the evidence. You have written what are the other global forces that might influence or already influence. It makes a beautiful story in that way. Okay? So we'll see. Now this is another way to analyze their policy. People also have used this, right from 1950s. Very important method. You will like it. Maybe many people will do this than the other one. This method is developed by UN, widely used to inform decision making, especially industries. A good tool to gain a full view of the different forces, a keyword again here, acting on a potential policy issue. So how do you do this? First, you list all the forces for change and the against change, and give them some scoring. I'm not going to show you the second slide. Now you can you visualize how this would have been? List all the forces, for example, the same climate change policy. List all the forces that are influencing climate change in Malaysia. What are they? For example, how this climate change is happening? Okay, you tell me anything that you understand. Climate change is a little scientific. You understand. You tell me any policy.
Poverty.
Poverty policies, okay. Why poverty in Malaysia? You list. Tell me. What are the ways? What are the forces for change and against change?
Many children are going to school.
Because many schools are not going to school, there is a poverty, okay? One. And?
Health problems.
Because health problems, there is poverty, okay? What else? Unemployment, okay?
Access to basic needs,
okay? Then this side, why this poverty is reducing already reduced because of what? Maybe, employment opportunities, what else, increasing literacy rates. Give the, changing factors and changing the factors that are responsible to exist poverty, still exist poverty, then give some ranking. Maybe this is easy now, and then you will come to know. For example, this is upgrade factory with new manufacturing machinery. Now they want to bring a policy to upgrade a factory with new manufacturing machinery. So they want to bring a policy like this. But before bringing the policy, or whether to come to this policy or not, they have done this analysis. What they have done? Why we should upgrade? Because the maintenance costs are increasing. That's where we need to upgrade. Raise volumes of output. When you increase the factory manufacturing machinery, it will also increase the output. So you have to upgrade. Improve the speed of production. Customers want new products. So there are many reasons. There are people saying that we have to upgrade because these things are happening. There are other people who are saying, no, you don't need to see that. If you upgrade, it's a lot of disruption, there's a lot of cost, there's a lot of environmental impact, new assessments, your staff will be frightened of the new technology, loss of staff over time. So you don't need to upgrade, it's okay. These are the two forces in a particular company that you can see. So at the end, the boss has to make a decision. How he or she will make a decision. So what he did, he gave some priority. He gave some ranking. Okay, maintenance cost increasing, that's correct. It will increase, but it's natural. Okay, you get just one score to that. Improve speed of production, yes, but it's also not a big thing, So you gave some ranking, 1, 2, 3, 4, some value that, you attach to each of this. Similarly to this, it disrupts, but that's okay, it's expected, it's not unexpected, so just one. Cost, yes, cost is a very important thing. Okay, you gave a lot of emphasis. Like you gave some ranking, then you total them. So what is the total there? 10. The total here, 11. That means you have to go for this.
So this is basically listing out the pro and the cons.
Cons and you have. That's it. So what are the forces acting upon and what are the forces acting against?
So
But any policy, this is what happens. Some people will be saying, yes, 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 you should. Some people will be saying, no, 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 and they have their own reasons. So find out all the reasons, give some ranking, and then add them, you will come to know whether you should do it or not. There will be biasness here. Why you should give maintenance cost only one? It could have been two also. It could have been three also. But since you are the manager, you are the decision maker, it is your analysis. So you gave the ranking, you total them, and you say, okay, there are 11 points here. That means there are forces against the change is more, so I should not go for upgrading it. But there are a lot of people seeing that it is not worth. So you have an evidence to tell the board, look, this is what I have done, and it looks like this is not the time to upgrade. What are the forces? What are the forces? So there are many other forces. You can also add one more here. The external links. Okay, the technology is cheap now. You know, there is someone who is giving the technology free of cost. You know, you can add another. Just it's a simple, there may be another force also. So put all the forces, give them ranking and see which one is working. It's not only two. Can you ask me a question? It's not only the two, this is two simplification. But it could be three, it could be four also. For example, there must be another thing here. Okay, there is a legislation that is coming up which will force you to upgrade, you know, like pollution, you know. Okay, there is a, if you upgrade your factory machinery between first 2 years, it's free.
Set of assumptions.
Put all this, give ranking, then you will be able to decide which is better for.
There must be some laws about.
Of course, this is also biasness.
Biasness.
There is a biasness in this. Any analysis will have some biasness. Human errors, biasness, and your preferences, whatever, we can talk about that at the end. Now I'm just introducing the tools now. For example, you want to analyze what are the forces acting upon in the breastfeeding policy. Find out. Then you will see, you know, where you are and where you can work more, where you have to focus your analysis more. So it will give you a little different idea. Now we are not focusing on context, but you are focusing on forces. So it's called poverty can be analyzed in many ways. Economists will analyze poverty differently. Political science people will analyze poverty differently. Social workers will analyze poverty differently. Like that, even policies can be analyzed from different sources, different tools. There's so many tools. I've selected these 5-6 because these are the tools that are usually being used in social policy and by the social workers. Very simple ones. We don't have a lot of time. We are working in organizations. There's not much resources, not much time. You have to, you know, analyze and produce to your boss tomorrow. Then you can use some of this. Look, these are the forces that I have analyzed, and this is what it is, and the score is this. Boss, you should do this or you should not do this. He will believe you once you do this. Otherwise, it's a little common sense, which is also okay. But then, once you use some of these tools, I think it helps even you and your management to make decisions. So this is called force field analysis. Find out what are the forces on this particular policy. Maybe from media, maybe from economics, maybe from the trade unions, maybe from the government, maybe, you know, there are many forces. Find out all the forces, give them some ranking, and then you can arrive on this. Easy? No.
Very easy.
It's very easy, at least to me. What do you think? What do you think? Oh, not clear. Okay. How can I explain this? This is called force field analysis. This is the word they use. Force field analysis. We are talking about factory, that is the field. We are talking about health. We are talking about migration. We are talking about women. We are talking about, you know, reproductive health. The field that you are working. What are the forces that is working on? Find out all the forces, all the factors that influence. Give them some ranking. Count them. You can say something. At least you're not just talking from common sense. You have some logic here. You identified all the forces, gave them some ranking according to your own, you know, views or some evidence,
and then you can come up with a good decision.
Yeah. In this case, it's not going to upgrade because this negative forces against the change are high. For example, USM also, our vice chancellor wants to bring some policy. He will do something like this, I'm sure. He'll find out, okay, if this policy, the professors will agree. The assistant professors will be okay, but the visiting lecturers will not agree. The students will not agree. Now he will find all this and then make calculations and then at the end, okay, I can still push this. Science, math, and English in a classroom.
In a primary school, that's
okay.
Something that.
That's here.
Okay.
Teaching science
and math.
Okay. Then what are the forces?
Okay. That's
let's discuss. No problem. That's no problem.
Because I also.
You have a pen? I'm sorry, I'm not bringing my that. So I can write this now. You just master this for today, it is enough.
Okay,
you want to work on this, right? You want to? The science. So, what is the issue there?
Teaching maths and science in English.
In English. Teaching maths and science in English. Okay, this is the policy you want to bring in.
Yeah.
Okay, what are the forces? Good forces?
English.
It improves English. Okay, what else? Textbooks are available, for example.
Able to produce world class science students.
Okay, world class science students. It's easier to find teachers if it's English. Easier to find teachers. Okay, what else? What are the negative? In mother tongue, if it is taught in English, not everyone can understand. Not everyone can understand. Okay, and then?
Expertise
is not available.
Cost
is high.
Cost.
Okay. Teaching in mother tongue is good. So, teaching in mother tongue is good. So, okay, now, among this, okay, 0 to 5, okay? 5 is the highest. One is this one. So improves English. What is the value of that statement?
Four.
Okay. Four agree?
Okay.
Four agree. Then not everyone understands.
Four.
Four.
Three.
Huh?
Three.
Okay. 3.5.
Equal.
Then textbooks. Then producing world class science students.
Two.
One. Easy to get teachers or what? Easy to teach or what? You're not convinced.
Two.
Okay. You don't need to follow 1, 2, 3. Basically, you can all do all three or. So now expertise is not available. Cost is high.
Four.
See, you already know this.
Yeah.
So teaching?
Three.
Mother tongue is good. So 3, 4, 4, 3.5. 7, 11, 14.4. And 4, 7. See?
Okay.
You're not much. Here. Okay, now we'll have one more, okay? One more.
Yeah.
So tell me now, what are the external things here? Maybe parents' willingness. Parents' willingness to send their children.
What else? Maybe Singapore, education in Singapore or neighboring countries, ASEAN. Everyone is teaching in English, and why not we? Or everyone is teaching in their own national languages, why we should, you know? So neighboring countries.
Ministry of Education
and their vision planning, whatever. So many things here you can also take into consideration.
Which will counteract the score.
So these are the external things. Look, friends, okay, we are not going for this now, but remember, if you are advocating for this, you will use all this. Remember, this is what happening. Okay, now it's fine, but these are the things that are going to come in. So please think about this when we factor into this, or when we factor into this. If you do this, I think it's more logical.
Actually,
it's
an ongoing issue.
It's ongoing issue, of course. And this is how people are fighting. And maybe one day people will say all four. And your policy is true. So you can see the negotiation here. People are, you know, giving different attachments. Someone said three, someone said four. Already there is a power issue here. If she is the Minister of Secretary, I will put three. If she's, you know, just a school teacher somewhere, no, I don't care, you know, and I will go for it. So it's all already influencing your own ideas here. Force field analysis. You do it from the media, you do it from the. There's a lot of things, you know. So that's why bringing the policy is not easy. I'm sure Malaysia one policy has taken a thing. If you read the history, Nazib is the first prime minister who went to a Malay school. Thing. Why he went? He is the only first prime minister who went to a Tamil school to speak to the students. Something like that. He is the first prime minister who visited a school by himself to find out the difficulties. Because he's talking about one Malaysia, how he will, you know, prove that by not going there? So you can see that there's a lot of, you know, context that we can understand from his policy, if you want to use that. Or what are the things, you know, help or not help to bring him? What must be the forces that help him to bring that policy? You can put that score and then you see that. I'm sure there are so many things that help him to bring that. So this is one way to do this. Shall we move on? Huh? We have just half an hour more. It's very easy, simple. Okay, now, if you also want to understand a policy, you want to analyze a particular policy, what we need to do is a stakeholder analysis. And this is another important word that you keep come across, but not many times we are not able to do a good stakeholder analysis. Because who is a stakeholder in the first place? All 30 million people. Any policy in Malaysia? All 30 million people are stakeholders, but we can't really analyze. Then we have to classify them. We have to kind of find out who are these important stakeholders that you cannot forget. You cannot afford to, you know, not to include them. So this is one way. Very simple again. It looks very complicated, but I like these abstract things. So that you, once you remember this, you can write what it says. How do we do stakeholder analysis till now? How are you guys doing now? Till now? Who are the important stakeholders in JKM, for example? Who are the important stakeholders for you? For the JKM? Who are the important stakeholders?
Stakeholders.
All the ministries, your line agencies, okay? Yes. Who else? We discussed that today morning, remember?
Yes.
Power. When I say power, you remember all that discussion that we had. All of us have such a power. Whether you are a minister, whether you are a common man, whether you are a disabled, whether you are a old person, all of us have such a power. Another interesting word here. Interest. All of us have such an interest to influence a particular policy because it helps me. Or I try to stop that particular policy because if it's not coming, then it's good for me. Or it should come, no? So all of us have certain power and all of us have certain interests. So just use these two concepts to classify your stakeholders. That is the beauty of this. I don't know who, where I have taken, and I have taken from the ODI, I think, the Overseas Development Institute in UK. They are the ones, I think, came up with this. Very beautifully done. You have high power, and you have low interest. For example, you are a very powerful person. You are a counselor. You are very powerful, but you are not interested in traffic policy. For example, in Penang, you are a counselor, but you are not interested in traffic policy, for example. You are very powerful. So what should I do with you? You are my stakeholder because you are a counselor. I'll just keep satisfying you. Just give you information about traffic policy, this and that, whatever, you know. So you are a very important stakeholder for me because you are very powerful, but you are not interested in that particular policy. So I don't need to worry about you. You're not a very, you know, in that way important to me. So I'll keep satisfying you. I'll just give you some information, this and that, it's enough. There are people like that. But JKM, maybe your other ministries, they're very powerful, but they're not interested in all your policies maybe. So just posting them. You know, they're important stakeholders, but just satisfy them. This one, what is that? That box? They have low power and they have low interest. Like you and me. I don't have any power, I'm just living in Desa Paramayanda. And I'm not interested in traffic policy also because I'm not going to be here for long. And I don't have a car. I'm not interested in traffic. Okay, no problem. There's red light, there's blue light. The road is okay, it's fine. So, there's nothing that you can do with me. I'm not a very important stakeholder. For just minimum effort. If I come to your programs, it's good. If I don't come, you don't need to bother. There are stakeholders like that. For example, if I ever call, you know. So, you don't need to worry about. If you can cover them also, it's good. Maybe, you know, one day, you know, I can shift my alliances. So, there are high power people, but they're not interested in issue. They're also important stakeholders. Keep them informed. There are people with no power, no interest. So, don't worry about them. What is this? There are highly interested, but low power. Poor fellows. I am very much interested in trafficking policy here because I have a child who is disabled. But unfortunately, I don't have any power. I am not a counselor, I am not a chairperson, I am not anything, I am not a media person, nothing. Again, what you do is just keep informing me. Okay, we are doing something for you, we are doing something for you, we will bring some good policy, this and that. Because I don't have any power anyway. This is important. You are highly powerful and you are highly interested in that. Then you engage with that particular group of stakeholders. Who could be in this case? For example, we are talking about trafficking, traffic policy, right? Who could be this?
Police.
People who are having vehicles. Young people who are making a lot of accidents. Who else? Media projecting certain kind of, you know, behaviors, because media is very powerful and they are very interested. Young people, young, I'm not saying one person, but youth, very powerful, they're very much, they're supposed to be interested, I don't know if they're not interested or not. So these are the people you engage closely and influence actively. Don't you think it's simple? So we need to understand our stakeholders, whichever policy that you are working on, but we have to also classify them. Otherwise, you will waste your resources, you will waste your energy. So, for example, here, trafficking, the traffic policy. Highly interested, highly powerful. Like people, young people, they're highly interested in this, but they don't have any power. Or they're neither powerful nor interested in trafficking because they don't care. So in that way, if you are focusing a lot of things on you, it will not bring any changes. Most of our policies fail because of that. If you really want to bring accidents, you know, the number of accidents to come down, where to focus? People focus on young people because, you know, they think that, you know, they are the ones who are making. But they are neither powerful nor interested. So there is no point focusing on them. Maybe we are making a mistake by focusing on them. So whom should we focus?
people with high power and high interest. Who are they? In this trafficking issue? Maybe people, insurance companies. They have a lot of power, a lot of lobbying, and they have a lot of interest in trafficking policy because they say that young people who are not carrying, who are drinking, and if they are making any, we will not cover them in insurance. Maybe they are the your real stakeholders to work with, not entry people. You have to really hit them so that you know they make policies good for young people. But unfortunately, we all focus, you know, awareness programs to send that only for young people and leave them, and our policy will not work. A good stakeholder analysis is very important for you to become an effective policy analyst. You apply for your own field, education, human, what is that? Your human donors. Find out who is the best stakeholder and whom to work with, because resources and time is limited. When you have limited resources, limited time, you have to get the better results immediately. So maybe this could help you to start, you know, analyzing the policy. Maybe first you do this, then you go to selling, then you go to stories, fixing. What a beautiful analysis will come. So certain people use all these models knowingly, unknowingly. I'm not saying only this you do, it's enough. No, maybe if you have time, you do another one. If you have time and resources, do another one. Maybe you have skills at one point of time, you can use all of them just like that, parallelly. You're analyzing the context there, you're trying to understand who is the fixing people, who are the important stakeholders. It happens. Now you have the tools here in your brain. You see now? So can you analyze a policy a little better today at the end of the day?
Inshallah.
Inshallah, we should be able to do this. And there is another one now. You have seen this? Yeah, this will keep it for the next one. Because it's only 15 minutes and I want to listen to your case studies. This is another classic, you know, tool that you can analyze. This is called prisoner's dilemma. There is a story behind this. I will anyway send this to you, and you just type in Google prisoner's dilemma, you will be able to understand. So some of the policies also, you know, results of your decisions and how people take decisions and how you can understand their decision making so that you can make better policies. We can go on to this. So what is this we have done now? And after the break, what is that we have learned?
Of
course. We talk about analysis tools. One is SELI.
Force
field, very easy. And stakeholder analysis. And before that, we have understood the storytelling, the engineering, the fixing. If you use these four things, your analysis will be done. In your term papers, I want to see these things. Not just, you know, cut and paste. Just use this. Okay, when you say that in the first line of your term paper, I'm going to analyze this policy and I'm going to use these other tools. I'm going to use force field analysis. I'm going to use stories. I'm going to use engineering, whatever. And I'm going to, you know, do the stakeholder analysis. Finished. Your paper will be perfect. Wow. It can be published.
Okay.
Yes.
Selection of model depends on the purpose of your...
Also. You have this, you know, tools here. So take, you know, useful tools. And the purpose, and the time, and the skills that you have, and the depth you want to go. Also, you know, so there's so many things here. So today, at least, you know a little bit more about how people are analyzing policies and how we can do it. I'm sure your senior is also doing this. Yeah, and there is the evidence then. Okay, now, any questions? Till now? I think I just explained this and leave it here. Okay, this is another very important thing. You know, a lot of confusion most of the time. Like, you know, she says, Basmati says, I'm a policy advocate.
No, I'm not.
I think she said in the beginning when she was introducing, I'm so passionate about this.
Yeah.
What do you mean by passionate? You're advocating, you're lobbying for it.
Yes.
You want to bring those changes. Okay, what else? How we'll see? What are the other names that you can see when people are talking about this? What are the other names? Apart from that, I'm an advisor. I'm a policy advisor. You know, you will see these names in JKM also, maybe. Now maybe tomorrow you will ask me, okay, why can't we advise? I'll become a policy advisor to JKM. Some of you will become policy advisors to some NGOs. What do you mean by advising? Some people say I'm lobbying for it. What do you mean by lobbying? What do you mean by advocating and what do you mean by activism? I'm an activist, I'm a policy activist. I'm a social activist. Can you find out the differences? Without looking at that. What is the difference between these four people? Because again, you will see many people in that four categories. Whatever you advise, whatever way you analyze, this is one way. Whatever recommendations you want to give, there is a smart way of doing it. When I say smart way, when you want to advise, when you want to lobby, when you want to advocate, when you say that you are an activist, when you want to recommend something, these are the things that you are trying to do. Your recommendations should be specific, they should be measurable, they should be accountable or action oriented, and they should be realistic and time bounded. Otherwise, no one is going to take your policy advices. No one is going to believe your analysis. What analysis? Okay, great, but I can't, implement this. It takes 20 years, 100 years, so I'm not going to take your policy. So your policy, it should be in a way that it should be smart. What do you mean by smart? Specific. Very specific. Look, if you really want to bring down the young people accidents, you do this. 1, 2, 3. Not like, 100 pages on that. Specific and measurable. You do this, you implement for 5 years, and the accident rate will come down by 10%, 20%, 30%. It should be action-oriented. And realistic and time-bound. The words itself will explain, but how do you do this? How can we be like this? How can we be a smart policy analyst? What are the tools you require for that? What are the tools? Silly? Post-field analysis? Stakeholder analysis? And policy entrepreneurs? Storytellers? Engineers? If you have these four tools, at least you reach some merit. And I was saying this, when you say an advocacy, what is that? Very simple. Actually, all four people are doing the same thing.
Advocacy, they speak for it.
They speak for it. When you're an activist,
they fight
for it. Okay? And when they advise, they're not affected by it. You're just advising, you're not affected by that. And when you're lobbying, you're part of that. Maybe. Or you're lobbying on behalf of someone. Simple again. When you are advocating, basically there are four things again. Your interest and your evidence. Remember, I told you evidence collection. Where is that we discuss this evidence?
Sally.
Sally, good. Now it is working. You have a lot of evidence with you. You have a lot of evidence with you and you are also highly interested. Okay, for example, you have evidence, and there are two ways to do this. You are a confrontational and you are cooperation, for example. Just to use these four words, you have a lot of evidence, you have a lot of interest, you have two approaches. One, you can confront and you can cooperate. You have a lot of evidence and you are a confrontational person. That's what advocacy is. You are advocating. You have facts. Look, our emission levels are 4%. It's increasing. You can see the statistics. It's evidence. And your approach is confrontational. You will do anything from that. You will stop vehicles. You will put some slogans. You do anything. You confrontational. You go out of law sometimes. You are advocating. But if you're an activist, what are you doing? You have a lot of interest. Also confrontation, no evidence. That's why many people, when they say activism, people say that get some evidence and come and speak to. For example, JKM, I go and then I have to have some evidence. Then they will listen to me. That's why advocacy may be a step higher than activism. When I say policy activist, I have a lot of interest, but I don't have evidence. both the advocacy and the activists, they use confrontational approach. But when you're saying advocacy, you're using facts, evidence. So that's why advocates, I'm advocating. Now when I'm advocating, I have facts. But I take confrontational approach. But when I'm advising, I'm not taking confrontational approach. I have facts and I also have a cooperative approach. Look, boss, these are the evidence. You should do this. Then you will get a lot of votes, a lot of mileage. You will be remembered. Your policy will be the best. You will achieve the better results. Do this, please. Only please do it for me. Whatever you say, you're advising by using inside stories, cooperation, whatever, stories. Do whatever you want. Very soft approach. You're not stopping vehicles. You're not, writing in media. You're not speaking. You're not, you're not confronting. Rather, you are working with the minister. You are advising him. Look, boss, this is what is happening in Malaysia. You have to do this. That's another approach. Maybe some social workers do this. They are not always, activists or advocates. But some look at this. Lobbying. Again, the same thing. You are not taking a confrontational approach. You are very cooperative. But you don't have evidence. It's only your interest. You lobby for women. You lobby for disabled. You are not disabled, but you lobby for disabled. You are not HIV, but you lobby for HIV people. You have an interest. You don't have a lot of facts there. So when it comes to policy analysis, you could be a policy activist. You could be a policy advocate. You could be a policy advisor. You could be lobbyist for a particular policy. So when you are using these terms, basically, what are the things? Four things. Evidence, interest, what approach? You are a confrontational person or a cooperative person. Very simple. So tomorrow if I am saying I am a policy activist, what does that mean? What is that? When I am saying I am a policy activist, I have a lot of interest, but I don't have evidence. When I'm saying advocating, I have evidence, but I'm confrontational. When I'm advising, I think all of us wants to be there. I want to be advisor. I want to use evidence, but cooperation, not like confrontation. When I'm lobbying, cooperation. Very simple. So these are some of the things I think will help you to understand who is a policy activist, who is a policy lobbyist, who is a policy advocate, all that you will come to. Similar, stakeholder. What are the things? Interest and power. Just two things. How do you define a stakeholder? A stakeholder is a person who has power and interest. Some people have highest power, highest interest. Some people have lowest power, lowest interest. Some people have low power and high interest. Some people have high power and high interest. The last column. You can find out your stakeholders. That's it, my friends. So you're all policy analysts now. I'm sure. No, I'm not just exaggerating. This is a very simple tools, but it's an effective tool. Use them and you will see what is the effectiveness of it. Thank you very much.